Luke chapter 23 this morning. Luke chapter 23, we've been walking through the book of Luke together, hitting some selective passages as we make our way to the Easter season. Luke chapter 23 this morning, I'm going to preach to you a message that I believe that there are five clear points that I want to make to you from the text this morning. I want to use a couple of illustrations, one from my own life, and then at the end of the service, or at the end of the message this morning, I want you to see a video that I think is pretty powerful. I've seen it before, but I watched it again this week, and I sat in my office as I was replaying it and just pumping my fist in the air. I'm on borderline of tears in my eyes just thinking about what Christ has done for me, and I hope that it'll be a blessing to you, but I think it'll fit well with the message this morning. But Luke chapter 23, this morning we have made our way. Last week we saw Jesus' first statement from the cross, and when he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do," and we looked at the issue of forgiveness. But this morning we want to look at the man in the middle. The man in the middle. Luke chapter 23, verses 39 through 43. You want to stand with me again while we read these passages or these verses this morning? Luke 23, verses 39 through 43. We've made our way to Jesus being crucified. He is now hanging on the cross, and we pick up in the middle of the scene. Verse 39. Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, "If you are the Christ, save yourself and us." But the other criminal answered, rebuking him, saying, "Do you not even fear God, seeing that you are under the same condemnation?" Verse 41. "And we indeed justly, for we receive the due rewards for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said to Jesus, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus said to him, "As surely as I say to you today, you will be with me in paradise." Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, this morning, we have read your word. We would like to heed your word, and we need your word to speak to us clearly. God, this is a passage that many Christians have heard and read hundreds, if not thousands of times. But God, today I pray our eyes will be open to it in a new fashion. Lord, for those in this room who aren't Christians, who have never heard this, I pray that you will use your death on the cross, which is their only hope this morning. Use the text, use the message to reach into their lost soul and change their eternity forever. We love you this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. The man in the middle. The most important day in the history of mankind. The most important day in the history of mankind is the Friday that Jesus died on the cross. All of you here this morning, you have probably in your life had impactful days. Maybe the birth of your first child, your wedding day, maybe the loss of a loved one, maybe your graduation. But we've all had very impactful days, very vividly impactful, and days that we can remember. But nothing is more important than the day that Jesus died on the cross. Historically, it's the most important day. It's the day that literally divides time in half, as you've heard me say before. The world is set up in two timetables, B.C., before Christ, and A.D., Anno Domini, meaning in the year of our Lord, that literally the cross of Jesus Christ divides time in half. History looks back on empires and wars and financial successes and powers and inventions, but all of eternity looks back over history through the lens of the cross of what Jesus Christ did. Now, last week you heard me say that all of Christianity crumbles without the resurrection. Well, this morning I want you to recognize that the resurrection doesn't happen without the events of the cross. When Jesus came and died on the cross, he did so that people like us could have eternal life. He didn't do it so that we would be perfect. He did it because we weren't perfect. The cross in our culture, though, sadly, has become nothing more than a trinket on a necklace. It has become nothing more than a symbol of some vague concept of religion that the world says is out of date and out of touch. The cross for many is a symbol of the local church, but not necessarily a symbol of a changed life. It's the symbol of religion, but it's not the symbol for repentance to many. It's just simply some trinket. But for the Christian that looks at the cross, they should instantly see their own wickedness and God's goodness. Many have concluded that the cross is just a cruel story, but this morning I hope that you'll see it for the salvation that is there. I found this story this week. I thought it'd be interesting to share with you. But in the state of Indiana, there's a graveyard with an epitaph that reads as follows. I don't know who the guy was that passed, but he wanted this on his headstone. He said, "Pause here, stranger, when you pass me by. As you are now, so once was I. As I am now, so you will be. So prepare for death and follow me." The people who owned the graveyard said that when this epitaph was put up, that shortly after it was, that headstone was raised and those words were placed there, that someone came along and scribbled onto the bottom of the man's headstone the following words: "To follow you, I am not content until I know which way you went." You know, this morning, which way you went is only going to be determined by what you do with Jesus of the cross. What you do with Jesus' death on the cross is going to be the determining factor on which way you went. So all of you in here, you've probably said before, "Preacher, I hope I've done enough to get to heaven." Let me let you in on a little secret: you haven't. All of you, or many people, have said to me, "Preacher, I sure hope I make it to heaven." I want you to know this morning, you don't have to hope. Many of you have said, "You know, I hope I've been good enough." Let me let you in on a little secret: you haven't. The beauty of the cross this morning is that Jesus died for us because our goodness would never be good enough. Jesus died on the cross for us because we couldn't be perfect. Jesus died on the cross in our place, taking on the sin that you and I committed so that he could give us eternal life. In 1830, a man named George Wilson was caught robbing the United States postal system. And when he got caught robbing the United States postal system, he was sentenced to death by hanging. But then President Andrew Jackson gave this man a pardon. From the top down, he received a pardon from the President Andrew Jackson. George Wilson, though, refused the pardon. He wouldn't accept the pardon. And so this went all the way to the Chief Justice. And the Chief Justice made the following statement in regards to Mr. Wilson's death, or his sentencing and his pardon from the President. Chief Justice said this. He said, "A pardon is only a piece of paper, the value of which is determined by the acceptance of the one being pardoned. The refusal to accept the pardon should result in the original verdict. Therefore," the Chief Justice concluded, "Mr. Wilson should die of his crimes." Church, this morning, Jesus' death on the cross is your pardon. This morning, the death of Jesus Christ on the cross is the pardon that has been given to you from the top down. Just as if Mr. Wilson here received a pardon from what you and I would call the highest earthly power from the top down, but he rejected the pardon and therefore died of his sins, died for his crimes. This morning, Jesus Christ's death on the cross is your pardon. You may feel as if you don't deserve it. You may feel as if you're not worthy of it. You may feel as if the punishment you should receive, or that you should receive the punishment that God dishes out. But the awesome news of the pardon is that it is a gracious act from the top down. And this morning, if you will receive and accept that gracious act, you, my friend, can be pardoned of your sin. Let's look at the text together this morning. Luke chapter 23. Let's look at the man in the middle. Very common text here, as many of you know, the thief on the cross. Many call this the repentant thief on the cross, or even the non-repentant thief on the other cross. But I want us to see the man in the middle this morning. There's five very clear truths that jump off of this text and out of this text to us this morning. But before we get to the text and show you these five things, I want to show you a few ironies that are in this text. As we read the story of Jesus' second statement from the cross, I want you to see a couple of ironies. Number one, the first irony I want you to see is the irony of blasphemy. Look at what he says here in verse 39. "Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed Christ," or Jesus, "saying, 'If you are the Christ, save yourself and us.'" The irony of the blasphemy is this: the criminal is blaspheming the innocent man, but the innocent man is being hung there because he was accused of blasphemy. So what we have is a man who didn't blaspheme God. and is innocent and is being hung there and is being accused of blasphemy and is now being blasphemed by the guilty party beside him. There's a lot of irony in this blasphemy. But there's also an irony in his statement of save yourself. At the end of verse 39, he says, if you are the Christ, save yourself and us. The irony of him saying save yourself and us is that the criminal wanted Jesus to prove that he was God by saving himself. And the irony is that if he saves himself, he doesn't no longer have the power to save him. That Jesus' death was the power needed to save the man, and the man wants Jesus to not save himself to prove he's God. But by not saving himself to prove he's God, he proves to him that he's God. There's a lot of irony there. There's a third irony, is the irony of condemnation. Look at verse 40. But the other criminal answered, rebuking him, saying, do you not even understand or even fear God, seeing that we're under the same condemnation? Paul said in Romans 8, chapter 1, that there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And what we see here is a man saying, we are under the same condemnation and we deserve this condemnation. But the beauty of the irony of this statement is that those who are in Christ are no longer condemned. And the man who is saying, we are under the same condemnation, is the man who's going to be let go of his condemnation. There's a lot of irony going on here. But these two thieves that are being crucified with Jesus in the middle, they've been arrested for the same crime, they've been tried for the same crime, condemned for the same crime, and were dying for the same crime. But what was the difference between the two? There wasn't any earthly difference. Or from an earthly standpoint, they're both dying for the same thing. They're rightfully convicted criminals who should die for their crimes. The only difference that we have here is that on their last earthly day, one of them humbly trusted Christ and the other pridefully mocked him. Now that's a big question here. Which one of those would you fall under? It is your last day, their last day on this earth, and one of them asked Jesus to remember him when he comes into his kingdom. And the other pridefully mocked him, saying, if you God, just let me see you save yourself. These two men bring about a very important question, a timeless question. What causes one man to believe and another not? What causes one man to look upon Jesus and be humbled, and another man to look upon Jesus and have prideful rejection of him? It's a very simple answer. If I want to avoid the deep theological answer with you this morning, the simple answer is this. Some allow their pride to harden their heart, and others allow Christ to soften their heart. Yes, it is true that God must first do a work in a man's heart, and God's Spirit must draw a man. That is theologically correct. But here what we see is one man's heart being softened by what Christ did for him, and another man's heart being hardened because of his refusal to accept what Jesus has done for him. Matthew Henry says, the cross to some is nothing more than the smell of death, but the cross to others is nothing more than the smell of life. Martin Luther spoke in regards to Christ's death on the cross by flipping the story upside down. And Luther said this. He said, Jesus Christ became the greatest liar, the greatest perjurer, the greatest thief, the greatest adulterer, the greatest murderer that mankind has ever known. Not because he committed these sins, but because he became these sins for us. Billy Graham put it even clearer. He said, in the cross, we see three things. Number one, we see the depth of man's sin. Number two, we see the overwhelming love of God. And number three, we see the only way for a man to be saved. This morning, church, I can't stress to you enough that Christ can save you. That Christ will save you, that Christ desires to save you, and he has the authority to save you, but it's only if you will trust in what he has done for you. Far too many of you this morning and far too many in our community are banking their eternity on the merit, on their own merits and not on what Christ has done for them. This is not just a crack in the foundation, church. This is sinking sand. So this morning, let's look at the text. I want to show you five things that are here. I'm going to use a couple illustrations and I'm going to show you a video at the end, so stay with me this morning. Five very clear issues on the issue of salvation right here from the man in the middle. Number one, Jesus alone saves. Now, this goes without saying here at a Baptist church. Obviously, we recognize that. And those of you who are members and have made professions of faith understand that Jesus alone saves, by His grace alone, through our faith alone, in Jesus alone. That we don't add anything to it. We don't subtract anything from it. That Jesus alone saves. But this text, above all text in Scripture, shows us how Christ alone saves. Peter said in Acts chapter 4, verse 12, that there's no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. 1 Timothy 2 said, there is one God and one mediator between God and man, and that is Christ Himself, who gave Himself a ransom for all. Probably more so than anywhere else in the Bible, we see this truth right here in this text. It's not for you to hold on to Christ. Christ will hold on to you. This morning, you must understand the salvation of Jesus Christ comes from the cross down. He substitutes Himself for you. This morning, I want you to see that Jesus, His death on the cross, is enough for you. That He holds on to you, that you don't hold on to Him. I don't know if... I wanted to show you the picture of it this morning, but I'm going to withhold it. But there's a meme that's floating around, and I pick on memes a lot because most of them are theologically shallow, and most of them are kind of ridiculous, but occasionally they're funny. But there's one that's been floating around. Now, let me be clear before I bash it for you, okay? Nobody's going to hell for liking it. Nobody's going to hell for sharing it. You're not a bad Christian if you have. Nobody's going to be mad at you if you have. Don't go back through your social media feeds and find if you were somebody who liked it and unlike it because the preacher... I'm not, okay? Just hear me on this. There's one that's been floating around that says something to this context. If you are holding on by a thin thread, make sure it's the hem of His garment. On the surface, I clearly understand what they mean. But I want you to know this morning that you don't hold on to Him. He holds on to you. If you were holding on to Him, your grip would slip. If you were holding on to Him, you would mess it up. If you were holding on to Christ, you would eventually let go. The beauty of salvation, as John calls it, is that Christ holds us in the palm of His hand. That we don't cling to Him as if He's dragging us along. He holds us in the palm of His hand securely. And that's the beauty of salvation. Isaiah puts it this way. Isaiah 41 says, I uphold you with my righteous right hand. He goes on to say in that same chapter, I'm the one who holds your hand. Church, if I was holding on to God, I'd drop it. I'd mess it up. I'd lose it. I would mess it up for sure. And this morning I am grateful that my salvation comes from Him. That He did it for me. I don't do it to receive it from Him. He did it for me. Martin Luther says it this way. Luther said, it is beautiful, wonderful news to know that salvation comes from outside of you to you. Not from inside of you out. I want to share with you something a man told me once. A very influential spiritual man in my life. Nobody in this room knows the guy from South Carolina. Older gentleman, retired, very wise man. And I've shared this with some of our adults here before, especially in some of our Bible study times. But he made this statement to me once that stuck with me and actually made me very angry. He said, Jeremy, you have never preached a sermon that has ever saved anyone. And my knee-jerk reaction was, well, that's not right. We've seen people get saved lots of times at the conclusion of a sermon, sometimes even during sermons. And he went on to elaborate by saying, Jeremy, your sermon may be the tool God uses, but at the end of the day, it's always Christ who saves. Never a sermon, never a song, never a church. It's always Christ. And Christ does the saving. You may use all these other things to be the tool, but God may use them, and God will use them, and we should do them. But at the end of the day, it's always Christ and Christ alone that saves. So what will not save you, church? This place? It won't save you. The brick and mortar of here won't save you. Well, I'm glad that we have it and we should be grateful for it. And I'm glad for all those who have sacrificed to make this church a reality for now almost 200 years. This pastor won't save you. I've heard people say this to me so many times. It drives me crazy. I'm just on my soapbox all over stuff this morning, man. But people say this to me often. Preacher, you need to go get that guy saved. Preacher, you need to go talk to them and get them saved. I can't get anyone saved. You do realize that today, right? God does the saving. And if God's working in their life, I may be the tool he uses, but I can't get them saved. God does the saving. This church won't save you. I can't save you. This aisle won't save you. I've heard people say it before. I just hope they'll walk that aisle. The aisle won't save you. Christ does the saving. He can save you in the pew, outside these walls. He can save you at a Super Bowl party in the basement of a friend's house. You know how I know? Because I'm standing here. Tony Evans said, you don't have to come to church to be saved. But he also said, you don't have to go home to be married, but stay away long enough and see what happens. What will save you is Christ. Christ alone, Christ first, Christ without any help from us. It's Christ that saves. And anything you want to add to that is legalism. And anything you want to subtract from that is liberalism. And this morning we must understand very clearly, as in this text, that Christ alone saves. What does this text have to do with that point? The thief on the cross asked Jesus to remember him when he come into his kingdom. What did the thief have? He had nothing but Jesus. He didn't have a resume. He didn't have anything to add after the fact. He didn't have a church to go to. He's about to die. All he had was Jesus. Jesus alone saved him. But number two, not only do we see that Jesus alone saves here, but we see that it's never too late unless it's too late. Number two, we see that it's never too late to come to Christ. Now, you may be thinking this morning, you don't know what I've done, Pastor, and you don't know how long I've put this off. It doesn't matter. It's never too late. You may run into someone who thinks that it's too late, but it's not. You may talk to someone who they think they're too far gone. They're not. You may know someone so stubborn, so hard to get through to, so sinful, so wicked, so anti-God, that you might even make the mistake of even thinking to yourself, they're too far gone. They're not this morning, church. The only answer to whether or not a man can be saved is whether or not the man is still breathing air. That's the only answer, church. If he's still alive, then it's not too late. And so this morning, if you're in these pews, you may be thinking, Pastor, I come this morning and I'm throwing myself at God's mercy. Good, that's your only hope anyway. Then you need to know it's never too late unless it's too late. Hebrews 9 says, it's appointed unto man once to die and then face the judgment. When facing the judgment, it is then too late. But if you still have breath in your lungs, then it's not too late. Now here's the lie Satan will tell you, church. Listen to me. Here's the lie he'll tell you. It's too late for you, and if you come to Christ, nobody's going to believe you anyway. That's a lie he'll whisper in your ear. It's a trick and a ploy for Satan to deter you from coming to Christ. Listen, heaven will welcome you with open arms, whether you've been saved for 90 years or 9 minutes. They'll welcome you with open arms. Jesus told the repentant thief on the cross that today you will be with me in paradise. So it honors God to save a man on his last day just as much as it honors him to save him in his early days. Jesus told the repentant thief, today you'll be with me in paradise. Not tomorrow, but today. Why? Because that thief is about to breathe his last, and it's not too late. Acts chapter 16, the jailer asked the apostle Paul, what must I do to be saved? And Paul's response was, believe on the Lord Jesus and you'll be saved. That's what the repentant thief did. He believed on the man in the middle. That's what he did. That's all he had and that was all he needed, church. Billy Graham said, the only person who can't be forgiven is the one who refuses to seek God's forgiveness. My friends, it's never too late. Number three, this text shows us that no one is beyond the reach of God. Not a criminal, not a churchgoer, not the lowest of low in the community, not the highest of high in the community. No one is ever beyond the reach of God. These men being crucified, they were criminals. They were so hated by society that their execution was done to humiliate them. They were so hated that their execution was being done to torture them, to cause pain to them, to make them suffer, so that their last earthly reality would be pain. But Christ saves one of them because that man trusted in Jesus, and he wasn't out of the reach of Christ. Listen to me, church. Peter denied Christ, and Christ saved him. Paul killed Christians, and Christ still saved him. David was an adulterer, and God still saved him. Rahab was a prostitute, and she wasn't even out of the reach of God's hand. No sin puts you out of the reach of God's hand. You cannot out-sin the grace of God. You can't dig yourself in a hole that God can't save you from. You cannot ever find a place where you want to go that God can't find you. You may say, Pastor, you don't understand how deep in sin I am. I don't know how deep in sin you are, but I do know how deep His grace runs, and His grace runs deeper than your sin that you're in. Maybe thinking, Pastor, I just mess up way too much. Newsflash. That's why Jesus died for you. You may be thinking, but everyone here knows about my sin. It's public. I can't come before the church and confess my love for Jesus. They all know about my sin, and it's public knowledge. Newsflash again. This is why Christ died for you. But Pastor, I've made the same mistakes over and over and over again. Matter of fact, they're not only public mistakes. And not only have I done them so bad, but I've done them repeatedly, so I'm just going to not come to Christ. Newsflash, one more time. This is why Christ died for you, because you are far from perfect. Today's crazy culture that we live in, of this cancel culture of nonsense and the lies of our culture and the world that we live in, says that you should flaunt your sin. You should live in your sin and flaunt it. But I want you to know this morning that Jesus died so that, not so that your sin could be flaunted, but so that your sin could be forgiven. He didn't die on the cross this morning just so you would be religious. He died on the cross this morning so you would be saved. And so we need to understand Jesus' death on the cross. Number one, that Jesus alone saves. But what we see here is that no one is ever beyond the reach of God. Not even a criminal on the cross on his last day. Number four. Salvation isn't about your deeds, it's about His deeds. Too many times we make church, we make religion, and we make Christianity about what we do for God. And I can't stress this point to you enough. It's not about what you do for Him, it's what He did for you. This text, above all others, proves that. This man hanging on the cross, he couldn't do nothing for God, or he could do nothing for Him. He had nothing to offer Christ. He wasn't going to have a perfect attendance Sunday school pen to show Him. He wasn't going to have anything to show Him. All he had was Jesus Himself. And all he had was relying on Jesus' deeds for him. Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, remember me. That's all he had. His only hope was Jesus. And this morning, your only hope is Jesus. Don't fall victim to modern liberal theology that believes that mere social ministry will be enough to earn you God's favor. You can serve and work in this community all you want, and those things are honorable, but those things aren't savable. The only thing that is savable is to throw yourself on the mercy of Jesus Christ. And don't believe this morning that God is grading us and weighing us on scales to see if our good and our bad outweighs each other. He grades us on the cross of whether or not we trust in Jesus. And Ephesians 2 makes this very clear, for it is by grace you have been saved, through faith, not of yourself. It's the gift of God, not by works, so no man can brag. True faith will always lead to good deeds, but good deeds won't always lead to true faith. Let me be clear this morning. God's people will do God's work as an overflow of what God has already done for them. Those who do good work in an attempt to earn God's favor will find themselves only more and more frustrated, because you'll realize it's never enough. Some people will have more time to do more work, but that doesn't make them more saved. Don't you say that again, church? Some people will have more time to do more work, but that does not make them more saved. The thief on the cross did all he could do in his final minutes, and his work was simply to trust in Jesus. If God blesses you, church, this morning with the gift of time, then don't waste it. If He gives you the gift of decades to serve Him, don't waste it. Number five and last. Salvation is immediate and it is permanent. The repentant thief did not have time to figure things out. All he had was Jesus. And he only had time to trust in Jesus. And when he trusted in Jesus, Jesus saved him immediately, and He saved him permanently. Hear me loud and clear on this, church. God never unsaves a man. God never temporarily saves a man. When God redeems a soul, He does so permanently. And salvation is a gift that cannot be earned, only received. And you may earn a paycheck, you may earn a diploma and a degree, but salvation can't be earned. It's only to be received by the goodness of God. And if we think that our works can do this for us, then the goalpost will constantly be moving. But Jesus made it very clear that it's only in Him that we find our salvation. Salvation is given to you from Christ, by Christ, and through Christ, and through Christ alone. Let me give you an illustration this morning. When I was in college in South Carolina, I didn't have a clue what I wanted to do with my life. And one day I hope I'll grow up and figure it out. But I didn't know what I wanted to do. So my first two and a half years of college, I was just taking those basic courses that everybody had to take. I didn't know what I wanted to do. And I got a decent job at Milliken Corporation. You guys know my story. And in my senior year, I was going to graduate with a degree in business when I started feeling like, you know, this is what God would have me do. It didn't make much sense to me, so I got in touch with Gardner Webb at the time. Long story short, ended up leaving South Carolina, went to Gardner Webb, took all my credit hours there, got to Gardner Webb, took all my theology classes, took all the preaching classes, yada, yada, yada. Well, it come time to graduate, and I was sitting in my advisor's office at Gardner Webb, and I'd brought in all the business courses that I had at South Carolina. And I'd taken all my theology classes and all my preaching classes, and basically I was done. All I need is my advisor to sign off on my graduation report or whatever they call it so that I can graduate. And so I'm sitting in his office, and he looks through my transcript, and he goes, wait a minute. You still need two more classes for your minor. So I'm looking at it thinking, really? I mean, he said, you need two more classes for your minor. And I had like 29 or 30, like basically a whole nother year of classes that I had brought in from South Carolina that just didn't count for anything. So I need like 120 credit hours to graduate. And I've got, at this point, like 149 credit hours. And he's telling me I need six more credit hours to graduate. So I'm going to have 154 hours, as if that will somehow make me now a graduate, whereas 149 wouldn't, when I only need 120. So I'm looking at him, I'm saying, can you please take any of those classes I took at South Carolina and just use them? Any of them. And he said, none of them fit. I said, well, change my minor to something that it will fit. I don't care what you got to do. Make it fit. He said, I can't. He said, you're going to have to take these two, whatever those two classes were. You're going to have to come back next semester and take those classes. And I mean, I was distraught. I was so mad. And right then, as I'm sitting in his office just scratching my head thinking, I can't believe I'm going to waste another 6 months of my life taking two classes I don't even need, don't even want. Y'all just trying to steal my money. That's all y'all doing. And about that time, as we're sitting there and I'm frustrated, he knows I'm frustrated, and now he's getting frustrated at me being frustrated. The dean of the school walks down the hall and just walks by his office door. We're just sitting there. And my advisor says, hey, Dean. He calls him by name, of course, and he says, come here for a second. And the dean just leans back over in the doorway and he says, what you need? And I had had the dean for a couple classes in preaching classes. And he said, Jeremy needs two more classes to graduate for his minor. He said, he's like, and? He said, can you come in here and sit down for just a second? I want to show you something. So he brings the dean in. The dean sits down. He shows him all these other credit hours I got. And he says, he's going to come back next semester for two. I'm going somewhere with this. Stay with me. He's going to have to come back next semester for two more classes, but he's got 29 other hours right here. Can we use any of these classes for his minor? And he said, what is your minor? I was like, business. He's like, but you were in business school before you got here, right? I said, yes. Weren't you a senior? Yes. You've taken all your theology classes? Yes. And the dean looks at him and he said, yeah, this is crazy. He said, we're not going to make you come back for that. He said, one of these two classes, or two of these classes, they're going to work. I'm going to sign off on it. He signed off on it. And he said, here's your graduation slip. You're good to go. I was so obviously elated at this. Had he not just walked by the door at just the right time? But here's what I want you to see, church. I only graduated because somebody higher than me signed off on it. All my work wasn't good enough until somebody higher than me signed off on it. And this morning, you may be looking at your life saying, I've tried. I've come to church more. I've tried to pray more. I've tried to read more. I've tried to do right. Your work will never be enough unless Jesus signs off on it. Unless Jesus and someone higher than you signs off on it, then, my friends, it'll be enough. But this morning, I want you to know that our salvation comes from Christ alone. That Jesus saves us just like he saved the thief on the cross. Jesus has the power and the strength to do it, and he will do it immediately, and he will do it permanently. Guess what, church? When the dean signed off on my graduation slip, I was immediately a graduate. And today I am permanently a graduate. And you can't unsign his name from my document. And this morning, if you're a Christian, guess what? Jesus immediately signed off on your soul. And he has permanently signed off on your soul. And there's nothing anybody can do to unsign his name from your soul. Amen? In conclusion, Charles Spurgeon once said that you'll find that true theology can be summed up in two short sentences. Salvation is all from the grace of God, and damnation is all from the will of man. I hope and pray this morning that you'll trust the man in the middle. I want you to watch this video as I conclude this morning of Alistair Begg. I don't know if you know who Alistair Begg is. He's from England, so he's got a kind of a funny accent, but he pastored in Ohio for a while. He's kind of become you probably heard him on the radio. But I'll just kind of set the stage for you here at this conference he's preaching at. You're going to kind of pick up in the middle of the sermon. There's only a couple of minutes here. But I think it's a very powerful message here. All right, so just listen to what he has to say.
Without the preaching of the cross, without preaching the cross to ourselves all day and every day, we will very, very quickly revert to faith plus works as the ground of our salvation. So that to go to the old Fort Lauderdale question, if you were to die tonight and you were getting entry into heaven, what would you say? If you answer that, and if I answer it in the first person, we've immediately gone wrong. Because I believed, because I have faith, because I am this, because I am continuing. Loved ones, the only proper answer is in the third person, because he. And think about the thief on the cross. And what an immense, I can't wait to find that fellow one day to ask him, how did that shake out for you? Because you were cussing the guy out with your friend. You'd never been in a Bible study. You never got baptized. You didn't know a thing about church membership. And yet you made it. You made it. How did you make it? That's what the angel must have said, you know, like, what are you doing here? Well, I don't know. What do you mean you don't know? Well, because I don't know. Well, you know, excuse me, let me get my supervisor. They go get the supervisor in you. So, wait, just a few questions for you. First of all, Are you clear on the doctrine of justification by faith? The guy said, I never heard of it in my life. And what about, let's just go to the doctrine of Scripture immediately. This guy's just staring. And eventually in frustration, he says, on what basis are you here? And he said, the man on the middle cross said, I can come. Now, that is the only answer. That is the only answer. And if I don't preach the gospel to myself all day and every day, then I will find myself beginning to trust myself, trust my experience, which is part of my fallenness as a man. If I take my eyes off the cross, I can then give only lip service to its efficacy, while at the same time living as if my salvation depends upon me. And as soon as you go there, it will lead you either to abject despair or a horrible kind of arrogance. And it is only the cross of Christ that deals both with the dreadful depths of despair and the pretentious arrogance of the pride of man that says, you know, I can figure this out and I'm doing wonderfully well. No, because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free, for God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. That's why Luther says most of your Christian life is outside of you, in this sense, that we know that we're not saved by good works. We're not saved as a result of our professions, but we're saved as a result of what Christ has achieved.
Let's stand together this morning. Because the man in the middle said you can come. That's why. Let's pray together this morning. Lord Jesus, thank you again for Mount Vernon Baptist Church. Father, I pray this week, the cry of the thief on the cross, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. I pray that we will remember that cry. And Lord, I pray that we will remember your response. Today you will be with me in paradise. God, help us to realize today that you, the man in the middle, is our only hope. In Jesus' name. Amen.